Okay, I believe we can start now. Thank you everyone for taking the time to join our webinar today. Today we will discuss a topic dedicated to enhancing business rules management by implementing rules in MuleFor. Our speaker for today is Tome Danoski. He is our Java technical consultant and has been with Interworks for several years now. So without further ado, Tome, go ahead. Please present your topic for today.
Thank you, Renata, for the introduction. Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Enhance Business Rule Management by Implementing Them in Your MuleSoft Project Using Drules and MuleFor. Thank you for taking your time for being here today, and today's agenda will be what are business rules, business rule engines and tools, the need for business rules engines, MuleSoft BPM support, implementing business rules in MuleFor, and an overview of custom MuleFor rules connector. So what are actually business rules? If we take a look at our everyday life, for example, we can see that somehow it is managed by some kind of rules that we perform on a daily task. For example, every time we set the alarm for the morning to come, we do so as we are following a certain rule that we need to wake up and start the day and maybe go to work, to school, or do our everyday tasks. If we do it, do not follow this kind of rules, we are still bound by the rules of nature. If, for example, you're going to jump, you're eventually going to touch the ground, as the rules of physics determine that you're going to touch the ground and gravity will pull you down. Some of those rules have been studied so much that they can be expressed by simple mathematical equations for example, for our everyday rules, we use some kind of common sense. We use a simple structure, so to say. This sort of structures are very important for organizations as they have to deal with complex scenarios. And these complex scenarios are composed, on the other hand, of a large number of individual simple decisions which work together and form some complex evaluations. These complex evaluations, on the other hand, start with simple assessments and are used to determine the nature of our environment that we can safely, for example, call interfaces. And these interfaces, on the other hand, might be crossed with other pieces of data or more interfaces until a complex view of the domain can be achieved. It can be understood, and actions can be taken down to for the benefit of the organization's goals. These implied decisions for a long time were a part of the system of many organizations through various, so to say, static structures, starting with the mainframe applications, for example, as services, web applications, as middleware solutions. These solutions always had some kind of tight coupling with the rest of their systems. Business rules, on the other hand, allow us for a specific easy to read and split structure to be used to define these decisions in a way that makes sense to different groups of people in an organization and not just the development areas. They can be quickly implemented and updated. As the term itself suggests, there are rules that serve to define or restrict some kind of actions in the process of companies. There are statements that describe how one must carry out certain operations and if there is some limit that they need to apply. They mostly guide behaviors and define what, where, when, why, how something should and needs to be done in a company. So exactly why should we use these kind of rules? If we think of it in terms of one rule, or maybe just a few of those rules, it still would be considered to do it the imperative code. Like we could implement them in some programming languages like Java, for example. However, the main strength behind these business rules doesn't actually come from one rule or a small set of rules. It comes from mostly from a large ever-changing group of rules that define a system so complex that would require extensive work to maintain if we did it with the regular code. Well, many rules can work together to define complex systems, whether we need to implement new requirements, modify existing ones, replace some parameters, or change the overall structure of our system's behavior in some new unexpected ways. And the only thing we would need to make those kind of changes with business rules and rule engines would be to replace the new ones, remove the not needed one, and add the ones that now apply. Well, that is possible since business rules won't work on different principles. They are mostly independent. They can be easily updated. Each rule controls minimal amount of information needed, and they allow more people of different backgrounds to collaborate and work together in defining this type of business rules. Another common question is, when should we use this kind of rules? Well, business rules are very powerful components. They introduce a large number of changes in the way we define our business logic, and they allow us to handle the complexity, the performance, and maintenance of our systems in order to accomplish a lot in a very short time period. These improvements are of great value for any project, and business rules can be implemented and added to any type of project that you might find out. These kind of projects usually have some kind of characteristics, so to say. They define some complex scenarios that are difficult to fully define even for some business experts. They do not have a well-known or well-defined algorithmic solution. They have more or less volatile requirements and need to be updated often. They need to make decisions fast, usually based on some partial amount of data. And of course, to conclude the introduction of part for the business, what are actually business rules? We also need to know when we should not use rules and rule engines. So every project in one way or another can benefit from certain business rules. They are highly performing, easy to change, and self-explanatory. However, there are a group of conditions that a project might have that would make use of business rules a bit of an overkill. Some of these characteristics that a project benefits the least from business rules could be there are very few self-contained rules involved in the project. If the business rules identified in the requirements gathering are very simple and span out one or two or a couple of objects at most, we actually would not need any rule engine to run them. A good rule of thumb can be also that if we can write this kind of rules in a couple of if-else statements, then we might not need a rule engine at this particular time. and the business logic might not change very often. And for example, a very strict control of the execution flow is crucial for the application, meaning that if a sequence flow control is not provided when we execute the business rules, if the business logic behind the business rules depends on a lot of strict steps that previously we would know to be executed sequentially, business rules might not be the right fit for it. However, if it does change frequently, perhaps a business process would be worth considering. On our next slide, we see and is dedicated to the business rule structure. So how actually those business rules definitions look like. Depending on every rule engine, it has its own syntax, but mostly the syntax, not very might be. Regardless, there is a primal structure that is common to most, if not all, rule engines, and that's something like shown in the slide here. So when a condition evaluates to true, then sequence is to be executed and propagated to the execution tree, so we can add as much syntactical sugar on top of this as we would like. However, the basic structure is this, what lies underneath every rule engine, a list of conditions and actions. A condition is basically a constraint or a filter. These filters will look for the information available in a domain to try and find data that meets the defined criteria. Once a group of data is obtained matching the condition, an action or consequence is to be executed, taking the matching data as a parameter. A condition always looks mostly like a query. It narrows down data from a specific domain by some specific filters. This means that a rule will make sense in a specific domain. So for example, if our rule engine expects us to feed it with apples, and the only data that we are going to feed it are bananas or oranges, of course, these rules will never evaluate to true, and the then action will never be executed. As simple as the structure might be, it is the basis of all business rules engines. And thanks to this structure, business rule systems provide a great advantage over the conventional code for defining complex scenarios. So writing rules mostly is a technical task, and by doing so, it requires a certain level of knowledge about how to define conditions and actions. And getting more people to learn how to write these kind of rules takes always a little more time. Well, if you get technical people to learn how to write these kind of rules quickly, sometimes it's not enough. It's not due to a technical limitation, but mostly to the people who hold the practical knowledge that we need to possess in order to write this kind of business rules are not being the most available at the moment. For those kinds of business people, there are platforms that allow them to write rules in a more user-friendly way. These platforms are a composition of user-friendly editors with some versioning and publishing capabilities called business rule management systems. In this presentation, we're going to see one of these editors. It is the JBPM Workbench. JBPM is a toolkit for building business applications to help automate the process and decisions. JBPM originates from BPM, which basically means business process management, but it has also evolved to enable users to pick their own PET in business automation. It provides various capabilities that simplify and externalize business logic and into reusable assets, such as business processes, case management, decision management, business rules, business optimizations, and many more. We are only going to see the business rule sections of JBPM, previously known as Drules Workbench. So before we actually go and see how JBPM looks like, we need to see why we actually would need this kind of business rules management system. These are just some points out of many that capture the importance of business rules management systems, of which are declarative programming. Rule engines, for example, allow us to write and to say how some certain things need to be done and not exactly how are they done. The key advantage is that using rules can make it easy to express solutions to difficult problems and consequently have those solutions verified. Rules are much easier to read than code. Rule systems are capable of solving very hard problems, providing an explanation of how the solution actually was designed and why certain actions were taken or made along the way. Logic and data separation. Data is basically our domain objects and logic is separated in the rules files. This is fundamentally breaking the object-oriented coupling of data and logic, which can be an advantage or disadvantage depending on your point of view. The point is that the logic can be much easier to maintain as there are changes in the future as the logic is laid out in a couple of rule files or maybe sometimes just one. This can be especially true if the logic is cross-domain or multi-domain logic, instead of the logic being spread across many domain objects or controllers, it can be all organized in one or more very distinct rule files. Speed and scalability. The RIT algorithm, the LIPS algorithm, and some of its descendants, such as Drules RITIO and LIPS, provide very efficient ways of matching rule patterns that for your domain object data. They are especially efficient when we have data sets that do not change very quickly, do not change entirely, as the rule engines can remember past matches. These algorithms are mostly battle proven. Centralization of knowledge. By using rules, you create a repository of knowledge, a knowledge base, so to say, which is executable. This means it's a single point of truth. For instance, for business policies, ideally rules are so readable that they can also serve as documentations. Tool integration. Tools such as Eclipse and web-based UIs provide very nice ways to edit and manage rules and immediate feedback validation and content assistance. Auditing and debugging tools are also available. Explanation facilities, which means that we are being able to log the decisions made by the rule engine along with why the decision was actually made. Understandable rule files, of course. They lend themselves to logic that is understandable to people that are mostly perhaps non-technical people, as all the program plumbing is hidden away, especially the how part. So before we actually go to news of part and depart, where we see how it is implemented, we need to cover what exactly are business ruling, are rule engines. Rules can be translated to execution drills, where these decisions are taken based on the data following a declarative approach. When we use business rules, we trust a rule engine to determine that how the rules should fire based on the domain data that we send to it. The rule engine transforms these business rules that we define to an executable decision tree through a specific algorithm. The performance of execution trees will depend on the optimization mechanism the algorithm can generate. We briefly mentioned rules as a workbench. The rules framework, on the other hand, defines its own algorithm focused on hard performance. This algorithm is called the FRIC algorithm and was created by Mark Proctor. It is based on a series of optimizations and redesigns of a pre-existing algorithm called RIT. The FRIC algorithm is one of the most efficient and performing algorithms implemented as open source. In the generated execution tree, every condition in our rules will be transformed to a node in the tree, and how the different conditions connect to each node in the rules will determine the ways the nodes will be connected. As we add data to our rule engine, it will be evaluated in batches and following through the network using the most optimized paths possible. The execution tree finishes when data reaches a leaf, which represents a rule to be fired. These rules are added to a list where a command will be called to fire all the rules that evaluated to true or a subgroup of rules. Due to this continuous life evaluation of conditions of rules, this rule engine bases its performance on having all of its data for rule evaluation available in memory. So each time we add more data to the rule engine, it is introduced to the root of the execution tree. So every optimization of this execution tree works according to a sort of set of points. It will basically try to break down or narrow down all the conditions to the smallest number of units in order to be able to reuse the execution tree as much as possible. It will try to make one operation go to one level below until it reaches a false evaluation of a condition or a leaf node where a rule is marked for execution. So every piece of data is evaluated in the most performing way possible. The optimizations of these evaluations are the main focus of every rule engine, or should be. So for our next or second part, we will cover what MuleSoft and how to actually implement this rule engine in Mule4. Well, prior to Mule4, MuleSoft had a JBPM module. It allowed to send or receive messages. It allowed to or from a running process. A message from a Mule could start or advance a process. The message could be stored in a so-called Mule3 version of a process variable, and the running process can send messages to any endpoint in a Mule application. However, the JBPM module was removed from Mule 3.8 and later, and there is no actual module that can be used as a business process management module unless we make a custom implementation, like the following I'm going to show you in a couple of minutes. So for our next slide is a demo. And for the actual implementation, we're going to need AnyPoint Studio, that I have already started together with JBPM for authoring business rules. So first of all, I would say, let me open just JBPM so you can see how it actually looks like. 8080 Business Central. So this is actually the UI for JBPM. As mentioned, we are going to use only the business rules or DRUS workbench part of JBPM for authoring rules. I've previously created a project with a guided decision tables where we actually define this kind of rules. We have some classification, NHTSA classification for some type of car depending on the weight of the actual car. It evaluates to what, how to classify this car. Before actually, okay, for this type of rule, as an object model, I'm using a simple Java class, which previously I added as a dependency to the DRUS workbench, JBP, that is. It was created in Eclipse, a simple Pojo with a simple property await and an enumeration class, which, so I can, we can see this nice drop down from JBPM. Of course, the data module I need to edit here. I'm only going to use this enumeration and of course the actual object model. After we define these rules in JBPM, we need to build and install them, which will be, which basically would make, and made, I made it, a jar file, which internally holds a guided decision table rules file with the actual rules defined here. Actually, it generates also rules files, which we can use later on, or just copy it from here. So for the next part, I'm going to create a project, a new project, that is. How should I name it? Webinar. Should be all right. It takes a little time when we actually define those kind of projects. So AnyPoint Studio is basically an Eclipse version. So should be familiar. Okay, so for our next part, I need to define, I would need the dependencies for DRUS, which I will take from this project here. Of course, we would not need all of them, but I just copy them, just to be sure. Okay, next we're going to create a package, call it com.enterworks, and of course a Java class that we can get hold an instance of the DRUS runtime or the rule engine. it's called just rule executor. It's a kind nice name. For the next part, I'm going to just create a public static method. With execute rules, and of course we need to add what we are actually going to feed the rule engine. I'm just going to call object in the vehicle, and for now we actually need to get hold of the rules and the rule engine, and we can do that by using the key services class, key services, which this one. This class basically gives us access to all other structures, such as providing a registry for our services where we can find any helpers for different purposes. We can get hold of the factory services and utility methods used along with the rule engine instance. We will also use key services to get hold of the key container, which defines the scope of the rules that we will use to create new instances of the rule file. We would actually also need release ID. This would be the actual jar file we previously generated from the JBPM workbench, which we called, let me just see, group ID com.interworks. Let me just copy this. New release ID. Here comes the group ID, the actual artifact name, which is vehicle classification, and the version number is 2.0.0. From, as I mentioned, from key services, we are going to create a new key container with the release ID. Okay. Just name it like this. And we will actually need a session for this. So a key container which defines the scope of the rule that we will need to execute and create a new instances of the rule engine. A key container can basically host multiple key modules and its dependencies. It means that it can start that a hierarchical structure of key modules can be loaded into an instance of the key container. And key module is a standard, basically it's a standard Java Maven project containing all the rules files, business processes and other assets among its resources. A special file called key module XML in the meta INF directory that defines the internal configuration about how to group these kind of rules, and it's also present in every key module. So we need, from the key container, we will need to create a new status Fashion Factory. Okay, let's call it session, for example. And from the session, we can actually execute or feed the rule engine the set, the object that it needs to evaluate in our type is the vertical. So we'll wrap this in a try catch. Just to be sure. And just print the error if there is an error. Okay, before I forget, since we are going to create here a new flow where we actually drag and drop this the certain components that we need. For example, we will need a listener that we will send requests from Postman here. We will, okay, let me just load. We will also need a transform message. It's a little slow sometimes, can happen. Just create a new configuration for the listener. Port 1234 and path where we can actually access the listener. It's called new, for example. For this part, I need to define, well, I don't need to, but I define it. Preview, so I know how the actual object looks like, so I can map it to the corresponding type. Just a second. Create an object from a class and a Java object and a vehicle, the one we previously added as a dependency in the POM file. What this does is it actually would generate a preview with the actual look of how the data in the or the properties in the object model would look like. Well, it does certainly. Maybe if I hit. I think I had it. Well, I did not. No problem. Let me just find it. It's not here. It is here. So this is the actual model type for the vehicle. Let me just drop down this. And we can create our preview again. I just clear the metadata and define it again. Not a RAML data structure object should be. And this is how our actual object looks like. Okay, I'm going just to map it out. I'm gonna take it from the payload dot wait and the NHTSA classification. Classification. Also take it from the payload. Next, we are going to create a variable to take the component. Let's call it vehicle. We're gonna need this name because we actually edit in the method named vehicle. And the actual value for this variable will be the payload that's coming through, and map it as object, which is of type com.vehicle, I think. Next, we are going to invoke it from Java. It's a module. Since our method is static, we need to invoke it as a static source, resource, as static method. So here we find the actual root executor class we previously created. And this should find all the methods that are implemented in there. It takes all this some time. Well, until we wait, we can, of course, add the arguments that we're going to fit to the method, which is the variable we previously created. Okay, here's the actual method, execute rules, which takes an object which we named vehicle, and also map this to the variable vehicle, which is of type com.intervals vehicle. And for the output, so we can see it in Postman later, we gonna map it to response as a JSON, the output. And again, the weight, we're gonna take it from the variable. Okay. Why does that vehicle? There it is. NHTSA. Location, which means we're gonna take it also from the variable which we previously throw into the rule engine for evaluation. And okay, before we actually start this, I'm gonna need to share the actual dependencies for the rules, since they are in a different class loader. Now, else it's not gonna see the dependencies we're using, and it will just throw an arrow that it can't find some certain dependencies from the rules compiler, I think it was. Just gonna paste it here. And after that, we can just run the project. Okay, I also need Postman to send a request to. It always takes a little time the first time starting a new project. Okay, here is Postman. Oh, I don't need the full screen. Okay. No, it can stay there. Nearly there. Couple of more seconds, I think. I just wait it out. Okay, it's deployed. And we can make an actual request to the listener, which is on HTTP. Localhost 8080. Not 8080, 1234. New. And we need to send a body, which is the weight. And after it's a post, we send it. Should get back a response soon. And yes, weight is 1789.0 and the NHTSA classification is a minicar. So seeing from, let me just, this rules files here, if the weight is greater or equal to 680 and lower than 986, the weight is, the vehicle is classified as a minicar. Of course, we can try it out with some other weights, let's say 1,250. If it still works, and it works, it's a compact as defined by this decision table. So this is actually how to implement the rules engine in Mule 4 and for the, well, kind of last part for our demo, we will see an overview of how a custom Mule 4 module is made. I have already imported the project. Let me just stop this. We will not need it anymore. And close the project. So this is actual, and open the connector, the new form connector. And see how it is actually made. We, of course, first need to define, we create a new project, remove any not needed flows that are present in source main mule, which are previously defined with every new project, and clear the dependencies. And since we all need only the apparent tag with the group artifact and version for the Mule SDK. So the basic point for every Mule component is the extension point, which basically means we need to annotate it with some annotations like the ones here, extensions, and name it how the actual module would look like what its name would be. And we can also add a prefix to for the XML file, and every extension should have a configuration if it would need, which I have previously defined to take some parameter as a string, which basically is a thread where we can find some Excel decision table, which we will see later. And of course, we will need every configuration can have some certain operations, which are the following. I've created a method here to execute rules we previously saw in the demo to load them from a jar file, and a method to load the actual rules from a rule file with the .drl extension. And of course, we can define any type of parameters here in the method, like I have here, for example, the content and the display name, how the actual facts should look like in the module operations, and the parameter group, which is previously defined in a different class, which I named jar parameters for the group ID, for the artifact ID, and for the version ID, since we are going to set this from any point, basically. We do not need any setters here, only the getters. After I've created this project, this connector, basically I would need to Maven clean install it so it can be installed in my local M2 repository, from where I can create a new project like here, add the actual dependencies, and of course the shared libraries, since this BPM module has its own class loader and can have its different dependencies and version numbers. So we need to make sure the main class loader is aware of which dependencies it's going to use. And also I need to add the BPM module, the connector, and classify it as a new plugin. After that, I've created some basic flows, which are basically some of the ones we previously seen, with the exception that instead here of invoking it from Java, or the module that we saw here and invoke it as a static, drag and drop it from the operations. I created this jar file in this file. We can of course try this out. So this is a file and this is a jar file. The listener listens to this pet jar, and 1, 2, 3. I don't know if this port is 82 reserved. Maybe it is reserved for me, not actual. I can also start the project. And of course it takes a little more time. Just change the pet here. And of course we can change the value to see that we are actually not actually doing something. One thousand and Excellent. Is it started? Still not. Couple of seconds more. Okay, so we can feed the rule engine some facts. And we have an output here. And these logs files are actually from the ones I've actually added a listener to the rule engine, so I can see the output, for example, what happened during the evaluation. And for example, here we can see that it is an insertion type. Basically, we inserted some facts that need to be evaluated. Okay, just stop this. For the actual rules files here, we can copy this, I think. We can. And I would need to create it somewhere. Maybe as rules. And the DRL extension to it. Just a couple more. So this is how the actual rule file would look like if we had it created manually, but of course we've copied here. Just save it. From our project here, we can specify where we can find this rule file, which is basically here. I hope I've got it right. And we can again start the project. Of course, I did not need it to stop it, but it's a, I don't know, a reflex of mine, just stopping. I think I've changed it right here. Okay, file 1, 2, 3, same configuration. And a couple of seconds more. It is started, and again, we can just change the path here so it matches the endpoint for the file operation. And again, we send some different values down the way. Maybe I just copied it. Okay, I got it right. The rule file and its evaluation is a minicurve. With that concluding, we actually finished the presentation for this webinar, and we can safely now jump to the questions and answers. Of course, if you have any questions.
Thank you, Tume, for your insightful presentation. It was truly interesting. We have some questions. The first one is from Blagoje. How easy it is for companies to adapt to using MuleSoft?
Let me just mute myself here. Well, it certainly depends. For example, if you're some huge company, a bigger company, for example, but with well-organized IT systems, it can be take less if your systems are not that well synchronized. It might, of course, take longer. So it all depends on the use case. But definitely choosing the right integration tool can help a lot. And of course, load the time.
Yes, probably then up the process. Thank you. We have another question from Marian. He says, interesting presentation. How do you manage rule changes? What happens when the rules change in the Drupal workbench after they have been approved by the management board?
Well, we need to update the actual. We need again to build and install the rules files.
Mm-hmm.
If that is the question.
I'm not sure, but. Okay, we will see a comment if that was not the question. Thank you. We have another question. How do Java skills complement with MuleSoft?
Well, since MuleSoft is Mule, basically it's written in Java, and Spring, it actually is really easier to grasp on it if you have a level of knowledge in some integration technologies, and of course Java, it should be very easy to get along with it.
Okay, thank you. Another question from Sasha. How important is to choose the right integration tool for a company?
Well, choosing the right tool actually is very important because it costs mostly time and money. Having the wrong tool can cost you too much, so it is not wise to take this kind of risk. MuleSoft is proven to be one of the best choices because 35% of most companies, like the Fortune 500 companies like Coca-Cola, already are using it and is choosing to be battle proven.
Yeah. We have a question from Natasha. What happens when the input value is not covered in the rules?
Can you repeat it again?
What happens when the input value is not covered in the rules?
Well, no rule can be filed since this kind of fact is not actually implemented in the rules file. So it either throws an exception or it's not evaluated depending on the rule engine.
Okay, thank you. Do we have another question? I don't see any other questions. Let's wait 1 minute. If you have any additional questions after this, feel free to contact us on sales@interworks.com.mk. We will be glad to answer your questions. Feel free to reach out. I don't think we have any other questions. So thank you again, Tome, for the wonderful presentation. It was very insightful. Have a good day, everyone. Bye.